Hey, what's up, everybody? This is Dante Fortson here. Today, we're going to be doing part four of the Jews in West Africa Before Slavery series. But before we get into that, make sure you guys hit that thumbs up button if you haven't already done so. Make sure you subscribe if you haven't already done so and turn on the notification bell. Also, turn on the notifications in your YouTube app so you don't miss any future videos. For those of you saying you don't get alerts, you have to have the alerts on the channel turned on to all, all alerts. And then you have to have the app alerts turned on as well. So that way you increase your chances of being notified before the video comes out. Now, if you like the videos, please share the videos across social media. I'm not one of these guys telling you I don't care how many people watch it. I want as many people as possible to watch these videos. So please share the videos. And if you want to support, you can do so with Cash App at #BHITB. The PayPal link is in the description. If you want to support on an ongoing basis, you can go to patreon.com/BHITB. And of course, you're welcome to hit the super chat. While we're live, you're welcome to hit the super thanks after the video is over. Check out the merch below the video. And if you want to become a channel member, click that join button below the video as well. All right. So now, quick recap. Oh, wait, before I do that, let me not forget to shamelessly promote Undeniable, full color evidence of Black Israelites in the Bible. If you're tired of arguing people about the evidence, just show them the images, because images plus the evidence and the sources, it makes it difficult for them to argue. All right. So now, moving on, get that on Barnes and Noble. .com or Amazon.com. A lot of people have a problem with the information that has been coming out, because they have made it up in their mind that no matter how much evidence is put forward, they don't want to believe it. You will have these people who just stepped into the subject, who haven't been doing this for a long time, and they'll say, well, I can't find the evidence. I don't see it. I'm trying hard to find it. Clearly, they're not trying hard to find it, because it's literally laying everywhere. They don't have any kind of paid subscriptions to any of the journals or any of the sites like JSTOR, JSTOR.org, for those of you who want to subscribe. It's only $20 a month. So they don't have any of these professional subscriptions or anything like that. And yet they'll tell you that they can't find this information when they could easily pay $20 a month like I do and have access to tons of information. They don't want to find this information, and that's just the facts. They don't want to see the evidence. This is why they wait for people like myself, Brother Benaiah Israel, Brother Ron Dalton, Pastor Kelly, Teo Ministries. They wait for people like us to bring out the information so that they can critique the information. But remember, they couldn't find it, so they need us to find it. They need us to find it for them. And so when we bring it out, they've already made up their mind that they're going to try to debunk it, or that it doesn't mean what it clearly says. So now we're going to talk about pictures, and we're going to talk about sources. This picture right here is the King's Fountain. This is believed to have been painted in 1570, and it represents, I don't know if it represents general life or a day in the life of Lisbon, but this is a painting of Lisbon, Portugal. Not sure if it's Lisbon in the 1570s or prior to the 1570s, but it is what it is. And if you pay attention to what's going on in this picture, you'll notice a few things. I'm not about to break down the picture. I'm just going to point some things out. You see these people in orange shirts here, here, you'll see them back here. You'll see them back here. It seems that only the Black people are wearing orange shirts, which I find interesting. You'll see these orange hats here. The use of orange in this picture is, I don't know what these things mean, but there's a lot of use of orange. So you see the men in the hats, they're usually white. You see the people with things on their head, the orange things on their head, they're usually Black. There's this guy right here that looks like, I don't know if that's a pot that got dumped over his head or some kind of torture device, and this is blood. I have no clue. You see this guy getting dragged off here. Some people say he's drunk. Some people saying he's being dragged off because he's a Jew during the Inquisition. And you also see these men with badges on their arms dragging him off. This right here, some people say he's a knight, but you see this guy is pointing at him. You see these two guys whispering here and pointing over at this Black guy. So if you look closely at this picture, you'll notice a lot of things. But one of the most, I'll say one of the things that stands out the most is that this picture seems to indicate that the population is almost half black. If you look real close, it's about half black. In fact, there may be more black people in the picture than non-black people. And again, this is Lisbon, Portugal. This was painted in 1570. It's called the King's Fountain. Now, for those of you who say you can't find the sources, all you have to do is listen to the words. I'm telling you guys exactly what the source is. If I don't or forget to put the link in the comments section, which is where I've started pinning them, you can always listen to what I'm saying and go Google these things and find the source for yourself. So now this picture, once again, Lisbon, Portugal, 1570 is when it was painted. It probably depicts a time earlier than 1570. So now let's jump over to here. And this is from a publication. This is on jstor.org, jstor.org. This is the link right here. You can type this in manually if I forget to put the link. Hopefully I won't, but I'll try to pin them down in the comments section. Identified as the enemy, being a Portuguese new Christian at the time of the last Kabbalists of Lisbon, authors Richard Zimler. This is published by Bergam Books, 2000. So it says, source, European Judaism, a journal for the New Europe, spring 2000, volume 33, number 1, The Exile of Jerusalem, which is in Sepharad. So this is from a journal. This is a section from the European Judaism, a journal of the new for the New Europe. All right, so I'm only going to read a section of this, and then I'm going to move on, because I got two sources for you guys today, and these are going to specifically talk about West Africa, the population of Portugal, what was going on during the slave trade, and how Jews are tied to all of this. And when I wrap this up, there's going to be something that someone worthy of mention points out. And I have to comment on it. I'll say that. All right. So, historic moments. Identified as the enemy, being a Portuguese new Christian at the time of the last Kabbalists of Lisbon. And for those that do not remember what new Christians are, they are Jews who were forced to convert to Catholicism during the Inquisition. And if you want a real, real good context on what I'm about to cover here now, you should go watch videos 1 through 3, and you will have a very good context on what is going on now. And the last video that I did, Judah's decree to enslave all white people, should be looked at as more of an addendum to this series. It's not actually part of the series, which is why I didn't title it part 4, but it is an addendum to this series. So watch those 4 videos if you want a full context on what is being talked about here. So let's start. I would like to describe the nightmare of being a Jew or new Christian during a unique period in Portuguese history, beginning in the year 1492 and ending in 1536, the era, not coincidentally, that corresponds to the event in a novel of mine that was recently released in Britain, The Last Kabbalists of Lisbon. To set the stage a bit, Portugal was then a wilderness at the farthest edge of Europe, a land where bears roamed forests of oak and pine, where wolves howled at night, and along with bandits, still threatened nighttime travelers along barely passable country roads. The main cities back then were the same ones as now, Lisbon and Porto, though the market towns of the arid south, Évora, Beja, and Elvas, for example, had a relative importance which they no longer have. Lisbon in particular was an island of commerce and relative comfort at this European frontier, hardly a metropolis in any modern sense of the word. It did nevertheless boast about 65,000 inhabitants, not to mention thousands of visiting sailors, traders, and travelers at any one time. It was above all a bustling port, where hundreds of stevedores servicing the great caravels offloaded cinnamon and pepper from India, silks from the Orient, gold from Africa, and even leopards and toucans from the New World. The Portuguese capital was then a jagged conglomeration of densely populated streets crowned by a hilltop palace with a central district running from Rosio Square down to the Tagus River at the Torreo do Paco, the old name for today's commercial square. To most visitors and residents, it must have seemed at times a place of unbelievable commotion, particularly the high streets of its era. New Merchant Street, which was about 300 meters long and 9 meters wide. According to a survey done in the early 1500s, it was bordered by 405 three- and four-story townhouses with 30 silk workshops, 11 booksellers, 13 haberdashers, 9 apothecaries, and dozens of other workshops and stores. Significantly, New Merchant Street ran right through the central Jewish neighborhood, and many of the shopkeepers were Jews. Yet, before we get carried away with the wonders of Lisbon, let us also recall that it was a city without any modern conception of sanitation or public hygiene. Imagine the stink of 43 fish scalers, 25 tripe sellers, 30 municipal butchers, and 50 rag dealers within an area no larger than Soho. Imagine also the stink of illiterate and lice-ridden residents spilling their pinnacles or chamber pots out of their windows while half-heartedly barking agua. Chamber pots are basically their toilets, for those that don't know. To passers-by treading the unpaved streets below, add to that the pungent odor of the dung heaps just outside the city walls, into which refuse, dead slaves, and God knows what else would be heaved. And then you know why my novel is so very full of sense. Let us also not forget that this was a time of plague and superstition, and of slavery and serfdom as well, because at the time, about 10% of the population of Portugal is estimated to have been Africans in chains, cleaning the ever-present muck from the streets and peddling water and provisions on foot. Now, listen to this part. After a visit to Portugal at this time, Clenardus, a well-known Belgian humanist, wrote, "The towns look like chessboards with as many blacks as whites." Interesting. The towns look like chessboards with as many blacks as whites. Which brings us back to this picture. And it seems that the picture coincides with what... Let me make sure I get his name right. Right here. Clenardus. So Clenardus says it looks like a chessboard with as many blacks as whites. So let's ask the first question. Does Portugal look like this now? Is the population half black, half white? And if not, what happened to all these black people? They said 10% were Africans in chains, and then the other guy said the town looks half black and half white. Because we know not everybody that was black in Portugal were slaves. So they're saying roughly 10% of the population were slaves in chains. But Portugal looked half black, half white. So what happened to the black population of Portugal? Where did it disappear to? Now remember, if you've been following the series, we know that the Portuguese Jews are black. They are described as Negro Portuguese and Black Portuguese. We saw in multiple sources. So now, once again, if Portugal's population was half black at the time of the Inquisition, why isn't it half black now? What happened to Portugal's black population? Now, I know some of you are saying, well, what are the demographics in Portugal now? This right here is published 22nd December 2023, Instituto National the Statistics or Statistics of Portugal. I'll say it that. I'm not going to even try to butcher that. So it says more than 1.2 million people have discriminated against in Portugal from 2023. So anyway, this is a summary of it. It says, according to the results of the survey on living conditions, origins and trajectories of the resident population in Portugal, people aged 18 to 74 self-identified in terms of ethnic origin or belonging as follows: 6.4 million with the white ethnic group, 169.2 thousand with the black ethnic group, 56.6 thousand with the Asian group, 47.5 thousand with the Gypsy ethnic group, and 262.3 thousand reporting having a mixed origin or belonging. The population who self-identified as Asian, mixed origin or belonging, black and Gypsy has a younger age structure than that who self-identify as white. So now, when we come back over here, he said, Clenardus, he says the towns look like chessboards with as many blacks as whites. And then we look today and we see that there are 6.4 million that identify as white, but only 169.2 thousand that identify as black. So once again, what happened to Portugal's black population? The only event that we know of where there were a mass amount of people that were moved or deported or forced out of Portugal was during the Inquisition, and these people were described as the Black Portuguese. History makes sense when you're consistent, but when you have to lie about history, that's when things start falling apart. So now, we know what this, we have an idea of what the population of Portugal looked like back then, and we have the idea of what it looks like now. So this next source I'm about to read, most of you will probably be familiar with this man that I'm about to talk about. Let me go back to the top. Now, this book was published, originally published in 2018, Homelands and Diasporas. This is the name of the book, Perspectives on Jewish Culture in the Mediterranean and Beyond. Now, let me just show you. When we talk about the Mediterranean, we're talking about this area right here. This is going to be Northern Africa area. So all the way from over here, all up and around here, it's going to cover parts of Europe. So the Mediterranean is going to include Africa and Europe. So just keep this in mind. In the last video, we talked about how Nebuchadnezzar sent Jews into Spain, the tribes of Judah, Levi, and Benjamin, and some of Simeon, up and down through here, all the way over to here to Spain, following the Phoenician route. So this is what we're talking about when we talk about the Mediterranean. So Perspectives on Jewish Culture in the Mediterranean and Beyond, a Festschrift for Emanuela Trevisan Simi. So for those that don't know what a Festschrift is, a Festschrift. Yeah, you can figure out how to pronounce on your own time. A F-script. This thing is basically a book presented to someone out of an honor for them. So this lady, they put together this book for this lady, Emanuela Trevisan Simi. This lady here. Why Jews Left Morocco, Different Narratives. So this is from the Center for Jewish Studies at University of California, Santa Cruz. This is some information about her right here. Emanuela Trevisan Simi is a professor of modern Hebrew and Jewish studies for Ca' Foscari University in Venice, Italy. She has done research about Jews at the margins, Kairites, Jews of Ethiopia, Judaizing movements, and Mizrahim in Israel. She has recently published a book in French on memory and representation of Jews in Morocco among Moroccan Muslims, Paris, published 2011. So this book was written for her and presented to her. These are the editors. And it was published by Cambridge Scholars Publishing. Now, When you see the word scholars there, it does not mean these are students. And I'm going to prove that to you because there's one in particular that we're going to talk about. Let me enlarge this so you guys can see it real good. Chapter one, right here. Essays, table of contents. No witness to bear. The settlement of Jews along the west coast of Africa, Tudor Parfitt. So Tudor Parfitt is one of the authors in this book that is dedicated to this woman. And he starts out in chapter one, and it goes right here. If you guys want to read the contributors, right here, a distinguished professor in the Stephen J. Green School of International and Public Affairs. You guys can go through and read all of this about Tudor Parfitt and everybody else. I will have a link to this. This is on CambridgeScholars.com. And here we go. Let's see. No, wait, let me get down to chapter one. All right, here we go. Now, once again, this was published in 2018. This first chapter is written by Tudor Parfitt. And I'm going to read through this, and I'm just going to point some things out that we've gone over and some other observations that should be noted. Now, some of the stuff he's going to talk about, I actually have read these sources earlier in this series. He's going to mention Peter Mark and Jose de Silva Horta. I went over their source, I believe, in part one of this series. So some of these names will be familiar to you and some of these names will not. But I'm going to point out some things. Now, before I start, I also want to point out that when you hear these Christians say they can't find any evidence for this, you have to ask yourself, why is it the Christians can't find the evidence for black Jews? And yet when we run across academics, they seem to be able to find the evidence for black Jews. Even the ones opposed to it, I read the source already. The ones opposed to it will admit that this is a topic of discussion among academia. So how is it who Israel is a topic of discussion in academia, but it's not a topic of discussion in the church where people claim to believe the Bible? There's a lot of questions we have to start asking ourselves. If Christianity is the truth, why is it that the truth is often fought against by Christians? If Christianity is about the truth, why is it they don't want to talk about the truth of history? Why do they want to fight against things we know to be historical facts in order to perpetuate things we know to be historical lies? We really have to ask ourselves, what is the real Christian agenda behind defending lies and trying to conceal the truth? Do me a favor, hit the thumbs up button if you haven't done so already. All right, chapter one, no witness to bear, the settlement of Jews along the west coast of Africa. It says the interrelationship between the African continent and the Jews has been one of the important strands in the work of Emanuela Trevisan. That's the lady it's dedicated to. In this paper, I should like to examine the little studied question of the settlement of Jews in West Africa. Following the persecution of the Jews in the Iberian Peninsula, it is well known that the remarkable energy of new Christians, whether Judaizers, committed Christians, or agnostics, played a major role in the Iberian conquest and transformation of the territories brought within a European orbit at the end of the 15th century or at the end of the 1400s. Now, notice he says, following the persecution of the Jews in the Iberian Peninsula. Once again, the Iberian Peninsula is Spain and Portugal. So he's saying this is after the persecution of the Jews. What was the persecution of the Jews happening? The Inquisition. So after the Inquisition is what he's talking about. Now, new Christians, once again, Jews that converted to Catholicism during the Inquisition under penalty of death. Some did so under the penalty of having their kids stripped away if they didn't. So we know he's talking about the end of the 15th century, or the end of the 1400s. That's where you're going to run into 1492, 1495, 1497. Those are significant dates. Their role in the Americas, the Ottoman Empire, India, and Europe has been well documented. Interesting, well documented. And yet you will see people on Christian channels claiming to be Christians, telling you they can't find any of this stuff. And yet we have Tudor Parfitt saying this stuff is well documented. Let's see what else Tudor Parfitt has to say, because Tudor Parfitt in this one chapter is going to expose a whole lot of lies and he's going to raise some questions. But the presence and impact of Spanish and Portuguese Jews in Africa over time has been somewhat neglected. the recent work of Peter Mark and Jose de Silva Horta, Kagan and Morgan, among other scholars, has begun to rectify this with respect mainly to the Senegal coast. Since the appearance of the work of these and other scholars, the broad consensus has been that the only Jewish communities to have established themselves in sub-Saharan Africa in early modern times were these small Sephardi African communities of Senegal's Petite Cote, a stretch of coastline south of Dakar. So now let's look what area they're talking about. So now if we look at the map, this is the area they're going to be talking about over here in West Africa. All right. By the 1660s, according to the Cape Verdean merchant Lemos Colo, Jewish identity was no longer a feature of the Luso-African descendants of the communities of the Petite Cote. Today, he wrote, by God's mercy, these ports are free from this wicked people, the Jews, and there are only some mestizos, their children, who in my time have been reduced to the Catholic religion. So what happened to them? Better yet, what are they talking about? The Luso-African descendants. We mentioned Luso-Africans before. Now, if we go back, we know that the Jews were put in St. Thomas. The source I read said that they escaped, made it to the mainland, and were called Lankados. And then they started to reproduce with the native women and produce Luso-African children. The children of Israelites are still Israelites. So we know that they were having children in West Africa with the native women. Now, once again, he says, today, he wrote, by God's mercy, these ports are free from this wicked people, the Jews. And there are only some mestizos, their children, who in my time have been reduced to the Catholic religion. So they were Israelites that converted. Because remember, the ones that were put down there, Hannah Adams and other sources, the source in Cochin, India, from the Cochin manuscript, said that Nebuchadnezzar had put the tribes of Judah, Benjamin, Levi, and some of Simeon into the Iberian Peninsula. The sources said they were black. The sources said they got kicked out. We see sources say that Portugal was half black. Now all of a sudden it's not half black. And the only time we know of a mass amount of black people getting kicked out of Portugal is during the Inquisition. It's not hard to put this stuff together because it's consistent. It says, as far as anyone knows, with the disappearance of these communities of the Petite Cote, there were no Jewish communities anywhere else along the whole West Coast, whole West African coast. Now, interesting that they just disappeared. But remember, he says this is in 1660s. The slave trade had already been going since the 1500s, really since 1495 when Manuel I gave the decree. But slavery in mass had been happening since the 1500s, where they were mass transporting people to different places. So now, if there is a slavery going on and you have a group of people in an area and they disappear during the slavery, it doesn't take a lot of investigation to come to the conclusion that perhaps these people were taken in that slave trade, because people don't just disappear off of the planet. It just doesn't happen. And if you want to point to the biblical cases, okay, those are one-offs. That is not the norm. The norm is not for entire populations of people to just disappear off the planet. But for some reason, you will have people that say, well, prove to me that these were Jews on slave ships. Well, where did they go? They either went to the interior of Africa, or they ended up on those slave ships and somewhere else, or both. But let's keep reading and see what Tudor Parfitt has to say. A couple of hundred years after Lemos Colho's, I'm going to say Lemos C, unpleasant comment, Edward Wilmot Blyden, 1832 to 1912, the Americo-Liberian writer and diplomat, noted that the great body of the Dark Continent has been apparently overlooked by the Jews. There is not, to my knowledge, a single synagogue in West Africa, along 3,000 miles of coast, and probably not two dozen representatives of God's chosen people in that whole extent of country. Not a Jewish institution of any kind, either for commercial, religious, or educational purposes. Have the Jews no witness to bear in intertropical Africa? But why would that be? Do we see in the Bible where Jews are running around building learning centers and synagogues and all that stuff? Do we see that in the Old Testament? No, we don't. In fact, in the New Testament, we see there at the temple. And then there are synagogues spread throughout, but that is not what was going on with Israelite culture. So we don't see that there. And then also, even if they were doing that, you have to remember that the story is that these were children that were banished to West Africa, children who survived the island and grew up. Their first priority wouldn't be to build learning centers and synagogues. It just doesn't make sense. The existence in modern times of Judaizing movements or of groups with some apparently Judaic characteristics in sub-Saharan Africa has usually been attributed not to the influence of any incursions of actual Jews or conversos, such as the one referred to by C, but to the activity of European colonists and missionaries who constructed, he put that in quotation marks, such communities sometimes as an exercise in comparative religion on the colonial frontier, and more recently to the agency of modern forms of communication, such as the internet. However, we shall see traces of Portuguese and Spanish Jews who had fled the Inquisition may be found in various parts of West Africa until very much later than the mid-17th century, and their influence on the local population, and therefore perhaps on contemporary Judaic manifestations, may need to be reconsidered. Interesting how he's saying this may need to be reconsidered. But people were saying they didn't see the evidence, but once again, Tudor Parfitt and others are saying, no, these people here were Jewish. There was a huge Jewish influence. These people were Israelites. And we've gone over much of the evidence for this. Let us first take a look at what is known of possible Jewish influences along the west coast of Africa, starting in the 16th century or 1500s. As we have seen, groups of Sephardi origin along the Senegal coast were almost from the start mixed Afro-Judaic communities. By the middle of the 16th century, some knowledge of these Black Jewish communities was widespread throughout the Portuguese-speaking world. So if there were communities in West Africa of Jews that were known and it was widespread and people knew exactly who they were, where they were, and he says it was Afro-Judaic almost from the start. What happened to these people? Did they just get overlooked during slavery? And then they were managed to escape and disappear somewhere, probably to Central Africa? Or were they targeted for slavery because the Portuguese had already been targeting Jews in the Inquisition? The Portuguese decree to enslave Jews had already happened to the in the Inquisition. And then later on, we're going to get into the papal bull, not in this video, but in part 5, we'll probably get into the papal bull where there is a decree from the Pope to enslave all infidels, which included Jews. We'll talk about the decree to not invade a country who already has a Christian king. We'll talk about all of that stuff coming up in the series. But the fact is, if you know these people existed there, what happened to these people? That's going to be the theme of today's video. I'm gonna keep asking questions. Let's see. No less a figure than the Archbishop of distant Goa, Dom Gaspar de Leo, wrote about Black Jews along the coast of Africa. In his introduction to a polemical anti-Jewish work written around 1565, some 5 years after the establishment of the Inquisition in Goa, he included a general denunciation of Jews who have rejected the Christian message. He wrote, "Judaism is an illness, one that lasted 2,000 years and claimed 2,000 million souls and had come about because the Jews had originally refused remedy from the hand of the ultimate medico, Jesus Christ." Now, you will still see some of these anti-Jewish, anti-Israelite sentiments among people who call themselves Christians. That's why they show so much hatred towards us and others who say that they are Israel but don't have white skin. The spirit of the Inquisition is alive and well in many Christian churches, including the black ones. Not all of them, because there are a lot of black Israelite churches out there that people don't know are Israelite. It says, this illness, which afflicted the Jews, had the effect that wherever they have lived, they have been cast down and rejected, so that even the black Jews of Guinea suffer this curse. Deuteronomy 28. We've talked about how Deuteronomy 28 was seen as Bible prophecy, always been seen as Bible prophecy. The only people that don't see it as Bible prophecy are these modern day Christians and people who don't believe in Bible prophecy in general. But within the body of believers, these modern day Christians are in denial as to what Deuteronomy 28 is really about. And we've covered that already. So he says they suffer this curse. How does one understand this? What he no doubt meant is that even those Jews who had escaped the clutches of the Inquisition and had established themselves safely in Guinea, that's in Africa, as Jews, and who even had the support of the local authorities, were not as well off as they imagined, and in any event could serve as a reminder to the faithful of the consequences of rejecting Christ, and could be sure that the curse would follow them. Now, Tudor Parfitt, to my knowledge, is not a religious person. So his understanding of some of these references without the context of the Bible, he does the best he can. And I'll give him the benefit of the doubt that he's doing the best he can, because I don't know him to be a religious person. I may be wrong. Whatever is implied by this reference, it seems as if by the 1560s, the black Jews of Guinea had become a byword for Jews who, despite everything, has survived Christian attempts to stamp them out. Who was attempting to stamp out people? The love your neighbors as yourself crowd. They were attempting to eradicate Jews, Muslims, and infidels all over the globe. So they went around slaving, murdering, raping, and had a convert or die policy. Do me a favor and press one if you always learned that Islam was the convert or die policy. Give me a two if you never learned about Islam having the convert or die policy. That is because when the Christians won, and remember, America supposedly was a Christian nation, so the Christians are going to give the narrative and make themselves out to be the hero. They were the ones that had a convert or die policy, because we can read through history and see that there were groups that hated the Christians so much. I read this before. The Copts in Egypt, the Copts, the Abyssinians, the Israelites and the Nubians made an alliance with the Muslims to kick out the white Greek Melkites. And we see this happen in other places. Muslims didn't have a convert or die policy always. They would make alliances with people to get rid of white Christians. And that's a historical fact. So let's keep going. Let's see. All right, I'll start right here. Whatever is implied by this reference, it seems as if by the 1560s, the black Jews of Guinea had become a byword for Jews who, despite everything, had survived Christian attempts to stamp them out. Even the black Jews of Guinea. Was Dom Gaspar referring to well-known communities of La Petite Côte, which is situated rather to the north of what is considered Guinea? Or was he referring to some other community further down the coast in this vast area known as Guinea or South Guinea, which stretched as far as Angola? Let me see here. Angola is here. So he's saying it stretched from here all the way over to here. And we know there were some up here because this is Morocco and they fled to Morocco. So we know that there is a Jewish presence, a black Jewish presence, going all up and down here. We know they're going to be in Central Africa, Northern Africa, South Africa. We know that these are the places they went according to historical records. It says the presence of isolated Jews of different sorts further down the West Coast, far from the La Petite Côte, is indeed attested in subsequent years by a number of Western travelers. John Ogilby. We have brought up John Ogilby so many times. Now, it's interesting that once again, you have these people who are opposed to this information say they can't find this. And here's Tudor Parfitt bursting their bubble. Now, for those who don't know who Tudor Parfitt is, real quick, this is Tudor Parfitt. Seems he's able to find this information rather easily. It seems other people are able to find this information rather easily. I've been able to find it. Benai Israel's been able to find it. Ron Dalton, Pastor Kelly, Teo Ministries. Everybody's been able to find this information except for the Christians who don't want Jews to be black. Amazing. The people with an agenda can't find the information that would debunk their agenda. This is why you have to be careful who you're listening to. The people with an agenda to prove that Israelites are not black mysteriously can't find any evidence that Israelites are black. Why would they want to? John Ogilby, 1600 to 1676, the English translator and publisher, expressed what was known at the time of the coast of Guinea. Once more, what was known at the time of the coast of Guinea. Many Jews also are scattered over this region. Some natives, some boasting themselves of Abraham's seed, inhabiting both sides of the river Niger. Others are Asian strangers. He meant simply that there were African Jews as well as lighter colored Jews living along the Niger. Interesting. What happened to all these Jews living around, among the Niger in the kingdom of Judah during the slave trade? What happened to it? Just disappeared, right? All these people just disappeared. The Jews got on slave ships. They were hitchhiking to America, having a good time on the Portuguese ships during the Inquisition, which the Portuguese were part of. See, y'all will listen and hear people tell you stuff that doesn't make sense. We know that these Portuguese Jews were black, and we know that Portugal was persecuting Jews during the Inquisition. And yet you have Christian channels that will allow somebody to come on and say stupid stuff like, all right, these black Portuguese Jews who were running away from the Inquisition in Portugal hitchhiked on the slave ships after the Portuguese had permission to enslave Jews, take all their stuff, use them as slaves, sell them for profit, whatever. They want you to believe that these same Jews got on the Portuguese slave ships as hitchhikers. Now, it may have been the case for some, but we know that the majority of these people were not hitchhiking on the slave ships. How do we know? Because we read it in Cambridge that to the extent that they were persecuted, they were more likely to be seized in wars and sold as slaves. But we're going to keep reading what Parfitt has to say. Reflecting on the nature of Afro-Judaic communities and how they evolved over the next century, Mark and De Silva Horta speak a good deal of syncretism. Although this is a term which is only rarely used these days by scholars of religion, undoubtedly among the Africans boasting themselves of Abraham's seed, there was a probably unconscious merging of traditions. One possible example of an individual of mixed tradition was spotted by a French traveler, Nicolas Villot de Bellefond, who undertook one of the first voyages on behalf of the French West India Company in 1666. He sailed down the Guinea coast from the Senegal to the Gold Coast, touching at many points. The Gold Coast is going to encompass some of what we know as Ghana. An account of this voyage with descriptions of the places visited was published on his return and soon afterwards translated into English. He narrowly survived a perilous crossing, and as his boatman was pulling towards the shore, the letter muttered in relief, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Mark and De Silva Horta devoted a considerable amount of space to this pious invocation of the patriarchs, which the boatman termed a fetish. Was this a trace of some Judaic past or influence? Perhaps indeed it was. Similarly, around 1700, we have a description of some black Portuguese inhabitants south of today's Senegal who appear to be, in part, descendants of Jews or new Christians, perhaps of the communities of La Petite Cote. We hear that in the kingdom of Bara was to be found a black nation which speaks some Portuguese. They build better than the Negroes, according to Labatt. The greater part of these Portuguese have no more title to the name Christians than of whites. For he says only some few of them are baptized, whose Christianity wholly consists in wearing a great chaplet about their neck, a very long sword by their side, a mantle if they can get one, a hat, a shirt, and a poniard. They are very ignorant, profligate, abhorred by the real Christians and despised by the Mohammedans or Muslims, who look upon them as a people of no religion, because it is well known that they never pray but when they are with the marabouts, and never go to the Christian church but about business. However, they are a very stout people, use firearms well, and are very ready and enterprising in business. They serve as factors up the river for the French, but in truth they are a dissolute race, squandering away upon women and wine, not only all they get themselves, but even what belongs to their employers. We shall conclude our account of them with a passage from Lemaire, who says they are partly Jews, partly Christians, that they generally carry a large pair of beads and are great cheats, very malicious, and in short, have all the vices of the Portuguese without any of their good qualities. Interesting, a black nation of Jews in West Africa in the 1600s. What happened to them? Where'd they go? In the same year, an English observer noted that on the island of Bassu, there were suspicions the Negrish Portuguese were of Jewish origin. Interesting, the Negrish Portuguese were of Jewish origin. They were suspicious of that. They have no hogs, neither the Portuguese nor Negroes caring to breed them. It can proceed from no religious principle in the latter, who are neither Jews nor Mohammedans. But what shall we think of the former? In the early modern period, there was something of a consensus that black Jews inhabited a number of localities along the West African coast, as well as the interior or Central Africa. This consensus had already been reached by the Portuguese, who imagined black Jews to be living in Angola, frequently accusing local circumcised males of being Jews, even though circumcision was universally practiced by the local Angolan Gentile population. Interesting, the Jews of Angola keep coming up. Let me go right here one more time. Angola is over here. We know that the Portuguese settled over here because we've read it in Cambridge before. Let me skip down to here. Right about here. And we'll read this because it adds to what we're talking about right now. This is from Blacks, Jews, the Religious Challenge, Cambridge University, published 1987, written by Ulysses Santa Maria. It's available on jstor.org as well. But what about the south of this margin of Saharan context? In the reign of John II of Portugal, nearly 700 Jews were taken from their kin and deported to the island of Sao Tome on the west coast of Africa. This island is close to Nigeria, Cameroon, and Gabon. Escaping from Sao Tome, the Jews immigrated to the coast of Angola between 1484 and 1499. They must have settled in several Portuguese colonies and over the centuries mixed with the indigenous black population. Near the Congo and Gabon in 1776, black Jews called Bavumbu or Mavumbu, that's going to come up in a minute from Parfitt, lived on the coast of Luango, that's going to come up in a minute, by the river named the Rio Muni. It would seem that they adopted Christianity at the same time as maintaining their Judaism. History is consistent. I'm reading from Parfitt in 2018 and from Cambridge or Ulysses Santa Maria in 1987, and it seems consistent, and yet you have these Christians with an agenda to prove that blacks are not Israel telling you they can't find any evidence. They're trying hard to find the evidence. They can't find it. Once again, it's very suspicious. Not even suspicious. I would be skeptical of anybody telling you that they can't find the evidence and their agenda is to prove that Israel's not black. They have no incentive to find the evidence. None. By 1847, David Livingstone discovered a group of educated blacks in the interior. Isn't that what Parfitt just talked about, the interior? Some 200 miles from the coast of Luando. These blacks were called the Jews of Angola. They were good merchants, learned easily, and had a knowledge of Portuguese law and history. They were often employed as clerks and writers. For Livingstone, there was no doubt but that these people were the descendants of those who had been deported from Portugal in the 15th century, the late 1400s, which is exactly what we were talking about. Other evidence supports this intuition. In Savage Africa, Winwood Reed writes of having met in Guinea, which is what Parfitt mentioned, blacks claiming to be Portuguese around 1864. Closer to our time, Dr. J. Kreppel noted sometime after the First World War that a large community of black Jews existed in the interior of Dahomey. These Jews had the five books of Moses written on old parchment in Hebrew. Now, I'll read this last part. Actually, I'll just read to the end of the sentence because it's going to mention something else. All these disparate elements are evidence of the permanent presence of a Jewish tradition within African ethnic groups, which had at one time been in contact with the Jews who came from the Mediterranean, were converted, and had kept their faith and their way of life. See, Ulysses Santa Maria assumes that they are converts. But as I mentioned before, the Mediterranean right here encompasses parts of Europe and Africa, but they made it all around here. But we have been reading that they mixed with the local population. People assume that the black ones are converts, but we know that the Portuguese Jews were black. So if the black Portuguese mix with black Africans, they're going to have black offspring, and these offspring are still Israelites. These offspring were practicing Judaism, which means they were not converts. They were originals. They were descended from the originals that Nebuchadnezzar put in the Iberian Peninsula. Do me a favor, hit the thumbs up button if you haven't done so already. Make sure you share this video. So all of this stuff goes together. So now we're back over here. In Tudor, reading what Tudor Parfitt wrote. Let's see. In fact, for the Portuguese, as for other Europeans, there was a powerful sense that there were Jewish polities or governments representing the lost tribes in the African interior. In 1830, for instance, a religious journal noted, "Africa therefore presents the only remaining likely place, and the advocates for the existence of the 10 tribes very confidently maintain that they are enclosed in the interior of that unexplored country." So wait a minute, in 1830, they thought that the lost tribes were in the interior of Africa. They thought the lost tribes were in the interior of Africa in 1830. Interesting stuff here. Now, for those of you who remember the Bill Horton source, he said they fled North Africa, and many of them went down into Central Africa and eventually into West and Southern Africa. So every source that we have covered says that they went into Africa. And here, Tudor Parfitt, one more time, this guy right here is giving you historical sources and information as to where they were believed to have been, and that is in Africa, West Africa, Central Africa. We know they were in North Africa, and yet you have the Christians telling you they can't find any evidence of Jews in Africa. The question is, what happened to all these Jews that were in Africa? Why did they believe the 10 lost tribes were in Africa? Why did they send the Southern Kingdom down to the west coast of Africa? And where are they now? I'm going to keep asking that question. Where did they disappear to during the transatlantic slave trade? Were they on the slave ships? Let's keep going. The widespread nature of this discourse and its continuing relevance over time may be adduced from the fact that when the British were planning a first expedition up the Niger in 1842 to the unknown interior, two London rabbis asked the expedition leaders to take with them letters in Hebrew and English, which they were to hand to the spiritual leaders of any Jewish communities the expedition might encounter along the banks of the Niger. So wait, why would they give them letters in Hebrew to give to any communities that they might encounter in Africa? any Jewish communities that they might encounter in Africa. Why would they think they were going to encounter Jewish communities in Africa when they sent an expedition? See, these are the questions that need to be answered by the Christian church. Because if you're going to say you stand for truth, you need to teach the truth. And you need to teach the truth about history and stop trying to debunk everybody when everybody is against what many of these Christians are teaching to be history. Let's keep going. A more sober note with respect to the coast of Luango, just north of Angola, was struck by the missionary John Clark, who wrote a very informative little book on what was known at the time of the languages and dialects of Africa, as well as the people and customs of the interior. He mentioned the town of Bonali in Luango, which contains 15,000 inhabitants. Many slaves from Mojambo and Kubanga passed through this country to be sent to Cuba and the Brazils. Oldendorp speaks of black Jews being in this part of Africa, but no confirmation of this has been met with. The practices common in many parts of Africa are those of sacrificing goats and sheep, making cuttings for the dead, circumcision, and the trial drink, and these do not particularly belong to the customs of the Jews. Jews along the coast, like Portuguese Christians, had close relationships with Africans living near the trading post, and as we have seen, they took African wives and concubines. So the black Portuguese took black African women and they had children with them, which would produce black offspring that look black like the Portuguese, black like the Africans. And when you have these people doing this for hundreds of years, it's going to create a population of Israelites on the west coast of Africa. And if you're in Africa and you're persecuting Jews and you're taking Jewish slaves and you're taking black slaves and you're rounding up people like the Portuguese did all the way from the Inquisition to the slave trade, chances are they're going to collect some black Jews in there. Chances are those black Jews who ended up on slave ships are going to end up on plantations and start having offspring. And there is where you end up with a whole bunch of people currently saying that we're descendants of Israel. And for whatever reason, the Christians will tell you they can't put all this stuff together. One of the Jews we know to have had initiated relations with a wall-off woman on the west coast was Manuel, the son of a spiritual head of the community in Porto de Ale, Jacob Peregrino, who was accused of sleeping with one of the daughters of the wall-off king. Not only did Portuguese take local women, they also sometimes adopted local dress. So they had native wives, and they dressed like natives. So chances are they could have been mistaken for natives. But let's keep reading. In 1619, the official start of slavery in America, there was a case where inquisitorial authority was brought to bear on a man born in Malacca and now living in Cachu, Guinea-Bissau, by the name of Manuel da Silva. He was arrested and taken to the Cape Verde Islands and thrown into jail. The charge against him was that he had been seen in Bashangir, today's Zinguacor, in Senegal, dressed like a local black, Como Negra de Terra, wearing rings through his nose as a boo-boo or bow-bow. Da Silva claimed to be a Christian, and he may well have been. In any event, there was no other evidence against him other than he had gone native. Reading between the lines, it might suggest that Jews and new Christians were even by this time prone to adopt the garb and habits of the local population, and this in itself was sufficient to attract the unwanted attentions of the Holy Office should they fall into its clutches. So now we're starting to put together more of history. So these Negro Portuguese or Black Portuguese are taking on native wives and having black children with them who would be Israelites. They started dressing like the local population. There's a slave trade going on in the area by the Portuguese who are already persecuting Jews, black Jews specifically, under the order of the Pope during the Inquisition. And yet people will say they can't figure out what happened to all these Jews. Where are they at? Did they just disappear from history? Or is it possible that they were the target of the transatlantic slave trade? As they adopted local dress, They also, in time, in some cases, adopted local beliefs. All right, I'm going to start over because I want to point something out. As they adopted local dress, they also, in time, in some cases, embraced local beliefs. In this way, the religious practices of Jews and Africans interacted symbiotically in the creation of religious practices analogous to those created by the fusion of Christianity and African religions elsewhere in Africa. Not very much is known of these new religious movements. Indeed, Judaic religious movements of this sort worldwide require more research. These dislocated people with such traumatic histories on the contested frontier between Africa and colonial interventions eventually, in many cases, lost contact with the Jews of the world and sought cultural reassurance in the religious and social landscape which surrounded them. Little is understood of this process. So now this can be confirmed or corroborated by another source, which I'm going to read right now. All right, so here we have West African Countries and People, British and Native, and a Vindication of the African Race, written by James Africanus Bill Horton, Cambridge University Press, 2011. This is actually a reprint. This is not the original date it was written, and I'm going to show you here. This book, first published in 1868, became the best-known work of medical officer and writer James Africanus Bill Horton, 1835 to 1883, who was born in Sierra Leone to parents of Igbo descent. He was chosen by the British to train as an army medical officer and attended King's College, London, and Edinburgh University. Let's see. He returned to West Africa and published his doctoral thesis, which was a medical topography of the region. Subsequent works called for health reforms. West African countries, however, went beyond medicine. In it, Horton refutes the derogatory racial theories about Africans rife in Victorian Britain and its empire, and he examines the possibility of self-government and how it might function in Sierra Leone and other territories in West Africa, foreshadowing the decolonization that took place almost 100 years later. So let's see if this man, who was born in Sierra Leone, West Africa, to Igbo parents in the 1800s who could clearly read and write, let's see what he has to say. And we're going to start from, we'll start from right here. This is page 186, and we're going to start at the very bottom, and I'm going to read down a couple of pages, and then we'll get back into Tudor Parfitt. Do not these religious rites and ceremonies remind us forcibly of the Jewish dispensation when sacrifices were made to atone for the sins of the people? And does this not present a emphatic proof of what Mr. Locker wrote, that part of the native religion of Africa, Judaism, forms an element which enters Africa by the natural current of nations from the north, northeast, from Egypt, Ethiopia, and northern Africa? All right, I enlarged it just a little bit. That though there are comparatively few Jews south of the Sahara and Abyssinia, still by the connection of the Jews with African countries since the days of Moses, Abraham, Joseph, Solomon, as well as the destruction of Jerusalem and the consequent scattering of the Jews all over the globe, the influence of Judaism on Africa is greater and farther diffused than that of the Jews and their geographical extension. If we take, for instance, the race under consideration, I will go still further and assert that the more we study them in all their various relationships, the more shall we be convinced that they form a portion of those lost tribes who disobeyed the command of God and were dispersed, but are now mingled with the original inhabitants of the country, and so degenerate in the form in which they now, or so degenerate in the form which they now appear. Interesting. So now he's talking about Jews in Africa. Now he's going to give, we're just going to read it, but he's going to give some interesting history here that's not talked about a lot, because we are told that Africans were swinging on trees with bones in their nose. They were worshiping the ancestors. They were worshiping Allah. They were Muslims. Now he's saying Judaism had an influence all over Africa. We're not taught that. Do me a favor and give me a one if you were taught about how much Jewish influence there was specifically in West Africa, but in Africa in general. Give me a one if you were taught that in school, not just after school, but in school. Give me a two if you were never taught that when learning about Africa and Black people during Black History Month. It says, but to prove this further, we must admit the acknowledged and everyday fact that the moving passion of men's minds, even from time immemorial, is a disposition to change their abode. Thus, the children of Israel, directed by some supernatural influence, migrated from Egypt to Canaan, expelled its inhabitants, and became sole masters of the land. The Phoenicians of ancient date were characterized by their spirit of enterprise, and they formed colonies in various quarters of the Eastern Hemisphere, adopting the views entertained in Northern Africa. We should conclude that migration was the natural effect of a far greater or more important cause. It is affirmed to be an immutable and essential decree of the Creator, who, when he placed the sun and stars in the firmament and directed their diurnal and apparent courses from east to west, ordained that mankind should not be an exception to the law which was intended for all the earth. Under these considerations, we see that the opening line between Egypt and Arabia, between Africa and Asia, known as the Isthmus of Suez, plays an important part in the history of Africa, as it formed the gateway for Asiatic immigration, and consequently, at various times, numerous Occidental tribes poured into Northern Africa through Egypt, either peacefully as immigrants and settlers receiving special license, as at the time of the Abbasid monarchy, or by force of arms. We find amongst the earliest tribes who tread the soil of Africa, the Babylonians, the Arabs, the Ammonite, and the greater part, if not all, Canaanites, which last were doomed to destruction by the hands of Joshua. And if we believe the account of Procopius, while the army was on its march in pursuit of Gilamir, who was afterwards led captive by Justinian by his general Belarius, it halted near the Numidian frontier, where a sculpted stone was found, whereupon was written or engraved in Punic Phoenician characters, which nearly correspond with the Hebrew, "We are the remnants of those tribes who fled before the robber Joshua, the son of Nun." Interesting, he mentions that description in Africa, that those who fled from Joshua fled into Africa. Now, here's where we're going to get into some more stuff where he starts to talk about Jews in Africa specifically. In those early days, Africa was known and famous amongst the civilized portions of the world, and the Assyrians and Babylonians were among its earliest conquerors, so that about 67 years after the destruction of the temple, we are told in Esther 1:1 that Ahasuerus, the king of Assyria, reigned from India unto Ethiopia over 127 provinces. And since the king of Egypt was considered lord of the people of Ethiopia or Sudan, we read in Isaiah that the king of Assyria led away the Ethiopians captive, young and old, naked and barefooted, to the shame of Egypt. Northern Egypt then was the most known portion of the globe, and into it vast immigration took place from time to time, even to the most remote period. Now, the 10 tribes of Israel, after they were left to follow the dictates of their own mind, and during the commotion and destructive warfare which ensued, to escape utter extermination, migrated, according to the usage of the times, in vast numbers into various countries, but principally into Northern Africa. We see the same thing with the Inquisition. They fled into Northern Africa. Some were placed into Western Africa. So, in the Bible, we also see them flee into Egypt, which is in Northern Africa. So when history is consistent, you have to ask yourself, why do these people constantly flee into Africa? Is it so they can blend in among the native population? Just a question. And if they keep fleeing into Africa, what happened to them? Just another question. So it says principally into Northern Africa, as it then presented the safest and easiest route. Once settled, every commotion and intestine war had the most powerful effect of inducing these migratory bands to shift their abode still further and so lose all connection with the other branch of the tribe. Isn't that what Parfitt just said about them in West Africa and Central Africa losing connections with the other branches of the tribe? As hundreds of years pass on and generation after generation roll away, they lose a great many of their habits and customs, becoming more amalgamated with the population which they associate. We just read Parfitt said that they were taking on the religious customs and the dress of the local population. And here in 1860, this is published in 1868, we see Africanist Bill Horton saying the same thing. But when Mohammedanism or Islam overspread Northern Africa, destroying by fire and sword all those of another religion, the Israelitish descendants or the inhabitants occupying the central portion of Africa, once again, Central Africa, passed forward seeking shelter to the south and west. So they ended up in South Africa and West Africa. So there's a migration of Israelites into West Africa. There's also a deportation of Israelites into West Africa. And we've read in Cambridge before that those in West Africa, some of them said that their ancestors came from Morocco. So if we're following what's going on here, Bill Horton in 1868, this book is saying that they came in through North Africa, ended up in Central Africa, and pushed into West Africa. We know from other history that when they fled the Inquisition, they ended up in Morocco. But in the same year that they were banned in Spain, they were also banned in Mali. So they couldn't stay in Mali. So they had to push further down into West Africa. And the other ones were shipped into West Africa, got off the island and started to populate West Africa. This is stuff that we know from history. And yet we have the people who are supposed to love them neighbor, love their neighbors as themselves and be about truth. They're telling you they can't find any of this. They don't know nothing about none of this. And yet the whole world seems to know everything about all of this, but they can't find nothing. So it says Israelitish descendants or the inhabitants occupying the central portion of Africa pass forward seeking shelter to the south and west. A part, namely those from the east central crossing of the Bainu or Joloba branch of the Niger, descended gradually southward and became intermingled with the original inhabitants. Protected from incursion on the north by the Bainu River and quietly settled between the Great Niger and Old Calabar Rivers, they remained in peace and grew from one generation to another in idolatry. We saw this in the Bible when Israel was not punished. They fell back into idolatry, which goes back to why when you have the Kingdom of Judah in West Africa, we see them worshiping snakes. They fell into idolatry. But let's keep going. But still leaving tangible proofs in the form of their religion of the Judaistic origin of the inhabitants. After this slight digression, we will now proceed to investigate more particulars relative to the tribes under consideration. The language, or the little of it that is known, is full of Hebraisms. Cambridge goes over that too. If you guys read Blacks, Jews, the Religious Challenge, it goes further into linguistics. The constructions of sentences, the verbal significations, the mode of comparison are all typical of the Hebrew. Like the Hebrew, from a single root of verbs and other elementary parts of speech, substantives, adjectives, and adverbs are formed. And the declination of nouns, the Reverend J. F. Sean, linguist to the Church Missionary Society, whilst writing of the cases said, there are none in the sense they appear in Latin, and consequently there are no declinations. But there are cases in the sense in which it is applied in the Hebrew language, namely that form of nouns to which are appended or suffixed the attributive or possessive pronoun. Well might a writer in the African times, when writing on the subject of black, the original color of the white race, finish his article with the following addenda. Pay close attention if you've never heard this before. The Isthmus of Suez plays an important part in the history of Africa and the Ethiopian race. Ancient mythology has proved that through its extensive through it, extensive migratory movement took place several thousand years ago from Asia Minor to Africa. From a little study of the ethnology of the language of West African and the Hebrew tongue, one is involuntarily brought to trace out a similarity in one of them to that of the tribes which, from disobedience to the will of God, were dispersed, and the greatest number of them possibly went to Africa. He's talking about the lost tribes of Israel. He's going to clarify. I mean the lost tribes of Israel. So now, they're saying that the lost tribes of Israel went to Africa here. Parfitt is quoting from people saying that they thought the tribes of Israel were in Central Africa. They had notes written in Hebrew in case they ran into Jews in Africa. And you have Christians today telling you they see no proof of this. They don't know what's going on. They can't find any sources. There was no Jews in West Africa. This is what they told us in the beginning. Then they told us they were white Jews. Now the sources say, no, these were Portuguese Jews. The Portuguese Jews are black. They mix with the native black population. They have black children all down the west coast of Africa, all in the interior of Africa. And yet nobody know nothing about these Jews. We don't know who they are. We don't know where they went to. All we know is they was hitchhiking on slave ships with the same Portuguese that were persecuting them in the Inquisition. They buddy-buddy now, and they just giving them, I don't know, medieval Uber across the ocean. They just booking ships like they book Ubers. Just take me across the ocean. I know y'all persecuting us. Just, I want to hitchhike across this ocean. This is the narrative that they've given us over the years. So, let me... All right, the lost tribe says, if the rites and ceremonies of the religion of the tribes bordering on the banks of the river Niger be closely examined and compared with the original religion of the Hebrews at the earliest period, viz. Ebo, Heber, tribe, if the Ebo language with all its corruptions be compared with that of the Hebrews, and if the peculiar disposition of the Hebrew tribes as detailed in scripture and that of the Ebos be properly investigated, that's the key, properly investigated, there will be a priori of reasons for a serious inquiry whether the Ebo tribe, which is but a branch of the Gala tribe in the interior, is the offspring of the lost tribes of Israel, driven down from Central Africa and forced to cross the Eastern and Bainu branch of the Niger by Mohammedan fanaticism. Now, they suspected that the Igbo were Israelites. We're not going to go over all that evidence right now. I've gone over it before in multiple videos. The memorandum to the president that calls the Igbo the wandering Jews of West Africa. We've talked about the Obadiah Alliance in 2022 declaring Igbo to be descendants of ancient Israelites. I have multiple sources spanning multiple centuries about the Igbo. We have John Ogilby in the 1600s saying that there were Jews living along the Niger River. Tudor Parfitt just mentioned Ogilby. So all this stuff is connected when you start to, you know, look at history and see that it's consistent if you're not trying to lie. I'm not going to read all this, but it's a lot of good information here. You guys should check it out. Now, one more time, I do want to show this map right here. We're still talking about this is the Gold Coast, as we heard about earlier. This is the Slave Coast. So you're going to have Ghana, Benin, Togo, and Nigeria all encompassed in these areas right here. This is Guinea. Negroland, this is Upper Guinea, and you're gonna have Southern or Lower Guinea down this way, going down into Angola. So this is the area we're talking about. And remember, the Kingdom of Judah is known as the Slave Coast. Hannah Adams said this is the Kingdom of Judah. This is Judah, Benjamin, and Levi. And then we had the other source that said Judah, Benjamin, Levi, and Simeon were sent into Spain as migrants, not slaves, by Nebuchadnezzar. And now we know they're forced down here. So let's keep reading. Tudor Parfitt says, perhaps a further glimpse of sorts may be offered from a source describing new Christians and the Capuchins' struggle against the elitist black secret order called the Kempasi. Even further south in Angola, the Kempasi used a cross-like sign in their rituals. Girolamo was a GM. Capuchin missionary to the Congo between 1648 and 1668 observed in puzzlement that the members of the Kimpasi Society had at the entrance of their meeting place a great portico or entrance with a sacred sign of a cross painted in diverse colors. M's colleague and contemporary Giovanni Cavazzi also observed the cross and noted the devil had taught the Kimpasi initiates that to entice new Christians, they should paint on their idols the venerable sign of the cross so as to hide their pernicious sentiments and their sacrilegious impiety. One would not believe, he admitted, how many people were seduced by this ruse. In this, an indication of anusim, in the spiritual dislocation of having been forced to give up one religion in favor of another, anusim are people who are Jews who are forced to convert to other religions. And through acculturation groping in the alienating circumstances of West Africa towards a religious manifestation which was familiar, the cross, yet thoroughly African. So basically, he's saying that the secret black secret society had adopted the cross. The devil taught them to use the cross to lure new Christians, Jews who had converted to Catholicism. The descendants of these Jews and other Portuguese immigrants, or I'm guessing that's immigrants, of Cape Verde Islanders and of West Africans developed a culture that was itself a synthesis of African and European elements. Now, don't confuse that word European with meaning white automatically, because there were black Europeans just like there are white Africans now in modern history. I know someone, went to school with someone, I tell people all the time. He's a friend of mine. He's on my Facebook. I'm not going to give his name out because the last time I did, people started hitting him up. But a friend of mine who is white that I went to school with, he is an African-American, and it says it on his license, and it has always said it on his ID that he is African-American. He was born and raised in South Africa, and in high school, or right before he started high school, they came to the U.S. He was the first person I literally met from Africa that I knew in a one-on-one basis. I knew of some black guys from Africa, but we weren't like friends like that. But I had PE with this guy and we had some mutual friends, so I hung out with him all the time. But he is an African American because he was born in Africa and then he migrated and became a U.S. citizen. So he is an African American. So yeah, you can have black Europeans, you can have white Africans. Don't confuse where someone is born with the lineage that they are from. And I find that is a huge problem in our community. When people say African, they act like that is a lineage. Africa is an entire continent. It doesn't matter what it used to be called or was never named Africa. That's irrelevant. The fact is, right now we call it Africa. And when you are born on that continent, you are African. Just like if you were born in South America, you're considered South American, North American. It's based on where you're born. Then you have lineage. Who did you descend from? What people did you descend from? So you can have an Israelite who was born in Arabia and he would be an Arabian Israelite. And if you have one that is born and raised in Africa, he would be an African Israelite, but it doesn't mean that they are descended from Hamites. And a lot of people confuse those two things. They say, okay, well, you're here in this location, so that must mean you are sub-Saharan African. No. Remember, the Portuguese Jews are put in West Africa. They're not sub-Saharan African. But they're in West Africa and they're black just like the sub-Saharan Africans. So you have to kind of use common sense when you read through history, and you have to have a good grasp on what history is going on. A lot of people who just got into this want to play expert when they haven't even done the work yet and they think they know more about history than they do. I'll read it one more time. The descendants of these Jews and other Portuguese immigrants of Cape Verde Islanders and of West Africans developed a culture that was itself a synthesis of African and European elements, which was despised by the Portuguese. The Jewish element of this mixed population, which in some places remained a discrete and visible element, seems in others possibly to have been absorbed by the host society. There are then numerous references after the 17th century to black Jews in various places in West Africa. Numerous references, according to Parfitt, and yet you listen to some of these Christians tell you they can't find the evidence. Somebody's lying. Either all these people are lying about what happened and Jews being in Africa, or it's the Christians that are lying to everybody. Remember, Satan deceived the whole world. If the Christians aren't telling you the truth, there's a reason for it. I would encourage you to start asking Christians about this history and see if they lie to you or not. And if they're lying to you about the history, it's one thing to say, I don't know because I never studied it. Okay, cool. That's acceptable. But if they start outright lying to you about history, saying things didn't happen that did happen, or things did happen that didn't happen, or any of these combinations of things, ask yourself, why is this person sitting up here lying to me about this history? What agenda do they have to lie? There are then numerous references after the 17th century to black Jews in various places in West Africa. One of these communities, while being little known or not known at all today, even by specialists in the field of African Judaic studies, was to exercise a profound fascination on Western thinkers and travelers for hundreds of years. This strangely unremarked group was influential not so much for what we know about it, because in truth we know very little about it, but for what it represented for Western thinkers for a very considerable time, and what it continued to signify in Europe until present times. There is evidence that there were black Jews along the coast of what is today the Republic of Congo, perhaps of Iberian or Spain and Portuguese origin, concentrated on the Vili kingdom of Luango, between the equator and the mouth of the Congo. All right, so this is the Democratic Republic of the Congo, and right next to it here is Congo. So you have Congo and the Democratic Republic of the Congo. All right, so now you have an idea. They're generally talking about this area right here, this white or this whatever color this is, this peached out area, and this darker orangish area right here. All right, so let's see here. The Kingdom of Luango was a powerful, trading centralized pre-colonial African state which survived until the 19th century or the 1800s. The Kingdom of Luango had a number of well-constructed towns, including the important wall trading town of Luango itself. The Malongo, Luango's ruler, played the competing trading nations, specifically the Portuguese and Dutch, against each other, and Vili middlemen operated as brokers between the local traders and European ship captains. This led to great fortunes being made, much of which was in the hands of African nobles. Now, here's where we get to some lesser known pieces of history. As we have seen, there was a sense in medieval Europe. So if we jump over here real quick, the medieval era, often called the Middle Ages or Dark Ages, began around 476 AD, following the great loss of power throughout Europe by the Roman Emperor. The Middle Ages span roughly 1,000 years, ending between 1400 and 1450. So we're talking about a roughly 1,000-year period from 476 to roughly 450 AD. It's considered the Middle Ages. So when you see this term, Middle Ages, this is that 1,000-year period where people had certain beliefs. All right, so now that you understand that the Middle Ages lasts roughly between 476 and 1450 AD, this will make more sense in context. As we have seen, there was a sense in medieval Europe that the interior of Africa, the interior of Africa was peopled in part by Jews in the form of the lost tribes of Israel. And this was particularly the case in the West African hinterland, or this is the area behind the coastland, basically. So one more time, as we have seen, there was a sense in medieval Europe that the interior of Africa was peopled in part by Jews in the form of the lost tribes of Israel, and this was particularly the case in the West African hinterland or coastland. So how is it that in the 400s, before 75 AD and 1450 AD, people believed that the Jews were in Africa? And now in 2024 AD, when we start to say that they were in Africa, people tell us there was no evidence. People tell us these were white Jews. People tell us they were hitchhiking on slave ships. People were telling us they were never on the slave ships to begin with. They have changed their story and moved the goalposts so many times. If you guys run into this, those of you who have been around for a while know how much the goalpost has been moved since day one, and never have we ever received an apology from the Christians who were opposed to this information. Not one time have we heard the Christians say, you know what? We were wrong when we said there were no Jews in West Africa. We misled all the people listening to us. We haven't heard that. Then when they said the Jews were white, I'm not going to say the sister's name because she can't defend herself, but nobody came to her aid when she said the Jews were white. And then after they did her dirty and kicked her out from among these Christian apologists, they started saying the Jews in West Africa were white. And now we see sources that say the Portuguese Jews were black. Specifically, the Portuguese Jews were black. The irony of all this information. And yet we haven't heard them come forward and say, you know what? We were wrong about these white Jews in Africa. This wasn't true. We misled you all historically. We haven't heard the Christians be humble enough to say that. And now the Christians have employed the help of an atheist that wants to convince us that not only does Judah, the kingdom of Judah, have nothing to do with the Judah of the Bible because it doesn't have an H, even though New Testament spells it without an H, so it must be the New Testament has nothing to do with the Judah of the Bible either. But his argument was it couldn't be Judah because it don't have an H. Widow means bird. These people must be descended from birds. Oh, wait, they don't have nothing to do with the Jews that were put down there, even though Hannah Adams and other sources say that these were the southern kingdom, the tribe of Judah, the kingdom of Judah. This has nothing to do with that, and they weren't on slave ship. They were hitchhiking. This is what they find to be intelligent. And some of y'all know exactly what channel I'm talking about. This right here is their most intelligent argument that they put forward, that these Jews were hitchhiking on slave ships. I'm going to keep bringing that up because it's ridiculous. We all know it's ridiculous, but the more I say it, the more ridiculous it sounds. And I'm going to keep saying it just so y'all understand how ignorant it is. The person is saying you can understand how ignorant they are. And they keep bringing them back on and they keep eating this stuff up because you have the blind leading the blind. When you have a person who runs a channel that's not really intelligent in the first place, or less intelligent than he pretends to be, he will let stupid people come on and say stupid stuff to a stupid audience who eat this stupid stuff up. Let's just call it what it is. It says, as we have seen, there was a sense in medieval Europe that the interior of Africa was peopled in part by Jews in the form of the lost tribes of Israel, and this was particularly the case in the West African hinterland. It appears, however, that a specific connection had also existed for many centuries between the Luango coastline and Jews. Some 15th century, that's 1400s, European maps designated the coast near Luango the Gulf of the Jews, Golfo de Judeus or Golfo dos Judeus. So the Gulf of the Jews in the 1400s in West Africa. All right, so you guys already know. I get a hint of something, I got to go chase it down. So he's talking about this map that references the Gulf of the Jews from the 1400s. So I went and chased it down. University of Wisconsin, Milwaukee had the map, 1492. Everything's adding up. The math is math and the map is mapping. Let's see here. All right, here's the map enlarged. And we're going to zoom in right over here because this is the coast of Africa. This is 1492. Let's come up over here. Let's see if we can find. Oh, right here. The Gulf of the Judeo. The Gulf of the Jews right here. Interesting. The Gulf of the Jews. Yep, it's there. The map is mapping. It's right where he said it would be. Gulf of the Jews. Okay. So, we know the Gulfo do Judeus or Gulfo dos Judeos. Let me see. What did it say? Gulfos de Judeo. Okay. So the map from the 1400s is legit. I guess Tudor Parfitt knows what he's talking about. I have a link to this. Let me see how to close this. I have a link to this here for you guys. University of Wisconsin, Milwaukee Libraries. It's amazing that 5 seconds on Google, I was able to find this map because I knew exactly what to look for because I read what Tudor Parfitt said and I just Googled the name Gulf of the Jews, 1400s, and came right up. And it's picture number 2, by the way, because there's multiple pictures on here. If you guys go on here, this is number 1. So picture number 2, Beheim number 202 is what you're looking for, and you're going to zoom or click this button to enlarge it and then zoom in over here, and right around this area right here, you'll see the Gulf of the Jews. All right. So now, you got the Gulf of the Jews. It says, speaking of the great voyages of the explorer Diogo Cao, the Anglo-German geographer Ernst George Ravenstein speculated, it may be presumed that Cao, in the course of his second voyage, gained a fuller knowledge of the coast first discovered by him in the north of the Congo. He may thus have visited and named the bay called Golfo Judeus, the Jews, Bay of Old Maps, either because there was a Jew on board his vessel, or what is less likely, because he was struck with the Jewish physiognomy of some of the natives. So this is a person speculating on why he may have called it that. But again, if we read through the history, we know where they were and we know why he called it that. But this other person is speculating, say, hey, he may have had a Jew on board, or less likely, he ran into a Jew or people who look like Jews. In addition, Martin B. Hames, B. Hames, 1492 Globe, the famous Erdapafel, Earth Apple, now in Nuremberg, calls the bay the Golfo de Judeo. And there is some speculation that Jews might have been exiled here following the persecutions of Jews in Portugal in 1487. So it's interesting that there's tons of records of Jews in West Africa, Central Africa, before the transatlantic slave trade. The transatlantic slave trade happens. These people are nowhere to be found and nobody knows what happened to them. No, we're just picking up Africans. But no Jews on board. They hitchhiked South America. They went over there. They went over here. They just using medieval Uber. Slave ships is Uber. This is what they got the atheists on the Christian channel teaching. The first reference to a black Jewish community in Luango is much later and comes from the pen of Christian George Andreas Oldendorp, the evangelical German theologian who in 1767 was sent to the Danish colonial possessions in the West Indies to write a report on the results of the mission of the Moravian Brethren in the islands. He worked hard and meticulously and produced a lengthy manuscript, only a third of which was initially published. The resulting work was published in 1777. In his book, he gave a good deal of detailed and credible information about Africa based on the testimony of slaves he interviewed. So, this man interviewed slaves. Let's see what conclusions he comes to from interviewing slaves. One more time. In his book, he gave a good deal of detailed and credible information about Africa based on the testimony of slaves he interviewed. His was the first written account, for instance, of the Igbo people. Among other things, he mentioned the existence of a black Jewish community in Luango. According to him, Jews had been expelled from Sao Tome, and it was from these banished Jews that the black Portuguese and the black Jews of Luango, who were despised even by the local black population, were descended. So the black Jewish community in Luango was descended from the black Jews who had been expelled from Portugal to Sao Tome, and they were despised or hated by the local black population. All of this seems to add up so far, and he got this information interviewing slaves. This is what it said. It is the testimony of slaves that he interviewed. So now I'm going to read this, and then I'm going to read something else about slave interviews. Interesting, when you start talking to slaves, what comes out? Oldendorp's informant gave further detail. The Jews were so despised by the Negroes that they will not eat with them. They have their own burial ground, which is located far from the dwellings of the Negroes. Their graves are a masonry, and figures of snakes, lizards, and the like are painted on them. Those who bury the bodies, or those who bury the body. This appears ridiculous to the Negroes. Since such paintings are so dissimilar to Jewish practices, the assumption is perhaps not improbably that the writing or letters on the Jewish graves appear to the Negroes to be pictures of snakes, lizards, and so forth. So you have these black Jews who are hated by the black natives, and they remain separate from each other. So now, I'm going to read something else about slave interviews. So this guy right here, Oldendorp, interviews some slaves, and they start telling him that the Jews of Luangwa descended from the banished Jews of Sao Tome, or the ones that are banished from Portugal and ended up in Sao Tome. Now, if we pop on over here to Blacks, Jews, the Religious Challenge, published in 1987 by Cambridge University, written by Ulysses Santa Maria, I'll read this short section. It says, from 1900 onwards, North and South Carolina were overrun by black preachers who were propagating a doctrine according to which the lost tribe of the House of Israel was none other than the Negroes. Although this might at first sight seem an odd claim, it can be seen as reflecting the beliefs that some black slaves had held during their captivity when they were interrogated on their origins, their destiny. Historical example supports this hypothesis. Then it's going to talk about Gabriel Prosser's uprising. So over here, we have Parfitt referring to Oldendorp, him interviewing slaves, and they're telling him that the Jews in Luangwa are descended from the black Portuguese Jews that got put in Sao Tome. And then we look over at Cambridge University. Remember, this is Cambridge University scholars published this one. And we look at another Cambridge University published book from 1987. And they're saying when they interviewed black slaves, they said they were Israelites. But people cannot find this information, and they cannot figure out why it is black Americans believe that we may be descendants of Israel. They can't figure out why those in the islands believe that they are descendants of Israel, and those in South America believe that they are descendants of Israelites, even though everything seems to point to the fact that they enslaved Israelites. I read the source, I think in part two, where it talked about the Negro Portuguese congregation that was kidnapped and put into the transatlantic slave trade during service. And the significance, I've talked about the significance of the Igbo before, but I'm probably going to cover that in part five or six of this. So far, there's going to be a part five, not sure about a part six yet. In part five, I'm going to cover the Igbo more in depth personally, because I'm Igbo and I know more about the Igbo because I've been researching it for personal reasons, and I would not do justice to all the other groups, but I will mention the other groups in the next part. But I'm going to talk more about the Igbo. All right, so now get back into Parfitt. Of course, the fact that these Jews did not eat with the local population is open to other interpretations than a refusal of the Negroes to eat with them. Was there any connection between these curious Jews mentioned by Oldendorp's observant slave and the Jewish connections along the Luangwa coast suggested by some cartographers and geographers some three centuries before? After Oldendorp's revelation, the Jewish community did not exactly explode with joy at the discovery of a new branch of the people of Israel. What they really mean is the discovery of the original branch, because it doesn't look good when you have Beta Israel, who's Ethiopians. They say, okay, these are Jews. Then you have the Limba, and they say, okay, these are Jews. And then you have the Igbo, and they say, okay, these are Jews. And then they keep looking and say, wait a minute, where all these black Jews keep coming from? And then people start looking, and you see that the black Jews are the ones who are mentioned throughout history. Where did these white Jews come from? People are going to start asking questions. Where did these white Jews come from? What happened to all these black Jews in West Africa? Where did they go? The black Jews disappear, suddenly white Jews are the norm. But before the black Jews disappeared, black Jews were the norm. So let me finish. I think we got about a page and a half left. After Oldendorp's revelation, the Jewish community did not exactly explode with joy over the discovery of a new branch of the people of Israel. No Jew, to my knowledge, went to discover the inner secrets of this remote community. 100 years after Oldendorp's book, during the 1873 German expedition to the Luangwa coast, Adolf Bastian, the polymath best known for his contributions to the development of ethnography and a member of the expedition, seems to have considered that there was indeed some connection between the ancient rumors of a Jewish population on the Luangwa coast and Oldendorp's community. He noted that in the land of the Brahmas on the Luangwa coast was to be found the place referred to by earlier geographers as the Golfo de Judeos. This is where, as he put it, the villages of the Mavumbu, or so-called Judeos, were still to be found to this day. So now we're going to pop right back over to Blacks, Jews, the Religious Challenge. Once again, I read this earlier, but I just want to reread this first paragraph right here because it's directly connected to what we're talking about. But what about south of the margin of Saharan contact, of this margin of Saharan contacts? In the reign of John II of Portugal, nearly 700 Jews were taken from their kin and deported to the island of Sao Tome on the west coast of Africa. This island is close to Nigeria, Cameroon, and Gabon. Escaping from Sao Tome, the Jews immigrated to the coast of Angola between 1484 and 1499. They must have settled in several Portuguese colonies and over the centuries mixed with the indigenous black population, consistent near the Congo and Gabon. In 1776, black Jews called Bavumbu or Mavumbu, which is the name we just saw, lived on the coast of Luango by the river named the Rio Muni. It would seem that they adopted Christianity at the same time as maintaining their Judaism, or new Christians, Jews who converted to Christianity. So we're talking about the same group of people. The Mavumbu is who just came up. The villages of the Mavumbu, or so-called Judeos, right there, the Gulf of the Jews, were still to be found in his day. So had a Jewish community persisted for some 300 years without any description of it reaching the Jewish world and without any known communication between the community and Jews elsewhere. After Bastian's visit to the Luango coast, although the community was frequently mentioned by the 19th and early 20th century scholars, no one else, to my knowledge, went to visit the community, and its later fate is unrecorded. Further north in Senegal and elsewhere, the ancient Jewish communities seem to have disappeared almost without a trace. They can't figure out what's going on. I keep telling y'all. Do me a favor and press the one if you heard me say that European history and Christian history has the most disappearing people in it. Whenever something becomes inconvenient to talk about, the people just disappear. Do me a favor and hit one if you've heard me say that. Two if you've never heard me mention that. I keep telling y'all, when something is inconvenient, it just disappears. Ask them what happened to the Khazars. They disappeared. What happened to the Scythians? They disappeared. What happened to the Aztecs and Mayans? They disappeared. What happened to all the Jews in West Africa? They disappeared. What's going to happen at the end of the world to the Christians? They're going to disappear. Everybody just disappears from history. This is like the world's greatest magic show, and God is like the world's greatest magician. He just disappears people from history. All the time just disappears people from history, and we never see them again. We don't know nothing about them. We don't know where they went. It's no way possible that anything else could have happened. However, let me submit a theory. The Inquisition was happening. The Portuguese were deporting them from Portugal into West Africa. The Portuguese had a decree to enslave them as one of the papal bulls. We'll talk about that later. And then they start enslaving people because the Portuguese had settlements all across West Africa, and they were the major part of the slave trade in the beginning. So the Portuguese start enslaving people, and we're expected to believe that they went to all the places the Jews were, Angola, the Kingdom of Judah, all up and down Senegambia, all up and down the west coast of Africa. The Portuguese set up shop, had a decree to enslave all Jews and infidels from the Pope. And yet they ignored all the Jews, the black Portuguese Jews. They ignored them, their wives, their children, and they specifically went after other people, even though the other people hated these black Jews. And while they were enslaving these other people, the Portuguese Jews were able to walk up to them and was like, hey, could I get a ride across the ocean real quick? Need a hitchhike. This is what the Christians are telling us. Yeah, press one if you think that's ridiculous. Press two if you think that makes sense. See, history don't make sense when you start lying about stuff. So now, we know what's going on here. They've disappeared, magically disappeared. It says elsewhere, the ancient Jewish community seemed to have disappeared almost without a trace. Is it fanciful to imagine that the B'nai Israel community of Eastern Senegal, now practicing Muslims, referred to in an article by Kanan Lipschitz, reported in the Jewish Telegraph Agency on May 23rd, 2013, refers to the descendants of these people? What traces are left of the black Jews of Luango? Good question, Tudor Parfitt. What traces are there? Where did these people go? Today, there are Judaizing movements in neighboring Gabon. If there are any connections between these movements and the black Jews of Luango is currently unknown and is a question that requires further research. Shout out to Tudor Parfitt. So now, we understand what was going on here. The Inquisition and the slave trade were both going on, conducted by the Portuguese, the same exact people. The Portuguese are in the same exact area as Jews. The Portuguese are running a slave trade. The Jews disappear from the area that the Portuguese who hate them are running a slave trade in. Press 1 if you have to be a rocket scientist to figure out what happened. Press 2 if you think it's basic common sense to figure out what happened. Press 2 if you got to be extremely smart to figure out what the Portuguese did with the Jews they didn't like and they had a mandate from the Pope to put them in slavery. Press 2 if you can just use basic common sense to figure this out. And yet, when you listen to some of the Christians talk, they will act like they have no clue what we're talking about. We're making it all up. They don't see no connection. All right. So now I'm going to wrap it up with this last paragraph, these last couple paragraphs here, because I think this tells it all. Cambridge University, 1987. Once again, same source, Blacks, Jews, the religious challenge. This is going to be on page 235. Now, we just heard about the Mavumbu. We heard about these people just magically disappearing. We know there's a slave trade and the Inquisition going on by the same exact people. Not different countries, just the Portuguese right now. The Spanish are there too, but right now we're focusing on the Portuguese. Same people as the Inquisition, same people as transatlantic slave trade. It says the study of customs and rites and the analysis of the semantics of these African tribes, talking about the language, and Tudor Parfitt mentioned this earlier. And so did Bill Horton. He mentioned it as well. The study of customs and rites and the analysis of the semantics of these African tribes have led many of their observers to propose some hypothesis and even draw some conclusions. Dr. Alan H. Godby reached the following conclusion. These factors have a very specific significance if we consider the presence of Judaism among the American Negroes. Why would there be Judaism among the American Negroes? Talking about the slaves here. If none of these Israelites, these Jews, these Black Portuguese, Negro Portuguese Jews, if none of them were taken into the slave trade by the Portuguese who had a mandate to enslave them, why would there be Judaism among American Negroes? I thought we were all had bones in our noses, swinging from trees, worshiping the rocks and Allah and all this other stuff they say. And yet there's a presence of American Judaism among Negroes. Or Judaism among American Negroes. I just want to emphasize that point. These factors have a very specific significance if we consider the presence of Judaism among the American Negroes. Hundreds of thousands of slaves were transported to America from West Africa during the trade, which started some 400 years ago, coincides with the Inquisition. What traces of Judaism still remained among the Negroes of West Africa at that period? To the extent that they were persecuted. Why were they being persecuted? Because of the Inquisition, number one, and we read that the locals hated them. So if you have an Inquisition that has an order from the Pope, a papal bull, to enslave the Jews, and you have a local population that hates them, what is going to happen? Well, the kingdom of Judah is going to get overran between 1624 and 1627 by the kingdom of Dahomey, modern day Benin and Togo. And what's going to happen to the kingdom of Judah? Is it likely that they were all massacred? No, that's not what happened. Some of them ended up in the slave trade. We have read the source about the congregation that ended up in the slave trade. We know that they were put into the slave trade, but let's see, basic common sense here. Hundreds of thousands of slaves were transported to America from West Africa during the trade, which started some 400 years ago. What traces of Judaism still remained among the Negroes of West Africa at that period? To the extent that they were persecuted, they were more likely than other Negroes to be seized in wars, during wars, and sold as slaves. It is virtually certain that many part Jewish Negroes were among those sent as slaves to America. How is it in 1987, Cambridge felt that they could publish this book written by Ulysses S. Santa Maria? And remember, before when we started the series, Cambridge puts their reputation on the line. So why is it Cambridge was willing to put their reputation on the line to publish something to say that Jews came over here on slave ships as slaves? Black Jews came over here as slaves on slave ships instead of saying, you know what? Maybe they was hitchhiking over here. Nobody in history, I've never run across anything in history that says the slaves were hitchhiking. Or let me back that up. Black Jews were hitchhiking on slave ships. Never seen it. Hitchhiking on slave ships. This is what we're supposed to believe. This has been their best argument because they have ran out of other arguments. And so now these guys, the only way to place them on the slave ships and justify that they were on the slave ships without actually being slaves is to tell people that they were hitchhiking. But remember, when they started, they said there was no evidence that they were ever there in the first place. And now they're experts on not only were they there, they were able to hitchhike across the ocean because they can't explain how they were there, ended up on slave ships in America, other than, oh, well, they weren't slaves. They couldn't have been slaves because if we say they're slaves, then y'all have a case to say that y'all might be related to them. And no matter what, our agenda won't allow it. It destroys a lot of their doctrine. It destroys a lot of doctrine if black people are related to Israel. I'm talking about descendants of slaves are related to Israelites of the Bible. So this conclusion. Put forward by Gabi, which argues for the existence or a more or less recurrent Judaism in West Africa in the same places as those from which the Negroes were taken, is shared by others such as Maurice Delafosse. But most significantly, it has been adopted by a class of educated black Americans as the key argument to demonstrate that the Jewish religion is the traditional religion of Africans brought in slavery to the American continent. Now, for those of you saying that these black guys are crazy for thinking that Judaism was brought in slavery to America, I'm going to show you this last source. 822 pages. We're definitely not going to read this whole thing. John Nutt, 1714. 1714. This is roughly, it's 5 years short of the official American start of the transatlantic slave trade. So again, 1714. Atlas Geographic, or A Complete System of Geography, Ancient and Modern for Africa. I'm not going to go through read all that. But if we come over here to page 39, 1714, this is when it's published, meaning it was likely written before then. It's going to get into a whole lot of stuff over here. Right here, it's going to say the present Christians in Africa. I'm not going to read any of this, but this is stuff that John Ogilby, some of the Jews who inhabited both sides of the Niger derived themselves from Abraham. Yeah, again, 1714, it's amazing in 1714 he knew about Jews on the Niger River, but that's not the part I want to read. This is the part I want to read over here. Judaism was the religion of the ancient Africans for a long time and succeeded by Christianity. But Mahometanism, or Islam, prevailed in the 208th year of the Hegira, when all Jews, Christians, and professors of the African religion that could be found were put to death. Yet in the process of time, their intestine quarrels made them neglect Muhammad's law and revolt from the Caliph of Baghdad, for which they were severely punished. Let me see. Oh, wait, that's the search button. I was going to see if I can enlarge this. All right. So I'll have a link to this. You guys can play around with this, enlarge it. But if you keep reading, it gets into some of the dates. He's going to reference some of the same stuff Ogilby referenced in the 1600s. But again, this is published in 1714. It seems to know that Judaism was the religion. Let me see. This one automatically turns the page when you scroll up. So one more time. Judaism was the religion of ancient Africans for a long time. So the fact is, when you're telling the truth about history, history is consistent. I'll have these links pinned in the comments for you. If I don't, you can always Google the names of all the sources I gave you and check them out for yourself. Shout out to everybody who continually supports. Please hit the thumbs up button if you haven't already done so. Please hit the subscribe button if you haven't done so. Make sure you share this video. If you want to support, you can do so anytime during the week with cash tag BHITB on Cash App. The PayPal link is in the description. You can hit up patreon.com/BHITB as well. Make sure you guys check out the merch below the video, and make sure you guys hit the join button if you want to become a channel member. So with that said, till next time, I'm out.